just want to thank Dr. Morris for doing so much to highlight the harms of the sexual revolution. And I came into this being concerned about the transgender agenda, and I didn't really understand how all the pieces of the puzzle fit together. How, you know, everything from pornography to comprehensive sexuality education, divorce, transgender agenda, it all fits together. And that's something that Dr. Morse has done a wonderful job of highlighting. And I just want to encourage people to help fund her new project, her new recording studio, so that she can continue to get the word out. Even though I have a lot of background about the transgender agenda, I've learned so much from Dr. Morris and the shows that she's done, where she's brought experts from all different areas to talk about what's happening in our world and how to fight back and how to stand firm to protect our children and our families, and to really push back against the ideology that's trying to break our society apart. I feel like Dr. Morris is not just a brilliant and amazing thinker. She's also a wonderfully compassionate person, and has been a dear friend to me, someone who reaches out to me during my time of difficulty to encourage me in my efforts. She provides lots of resources to people like me who are out there in the field doing activism. And I just think that of all the people that I run into, she's one of the most fierce and committed, and really just has done so much to protect us from this incredibly dangerous ideologies that are threatening our families, our religious beliefs, our children, and our society as a whole. So I just want to thank her for everything that she has done, for her providing me with resources and a platform, for her encouragement, for her friendship, and for her insights. She is a brilliant and wonderful person, and I encourage you to support her efforts wholeheartedly. Thank you so much.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Robeck Morris, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. My guest on today's episode of the Dr. J Show is Mr. Don Johnson, who is a documentary filmmaker and who has a new and very fascinating documentary that I know you're going to love. Don, welcome to the Dr. J Show.
Thank you very much, Dr. Morris. Good to see you.
Yeah, good to see you again, too. So you're a producer of a new documentary called Dysconnected, where dys is spelled D-Y-S, building on the word dysphoria, I suppose. So you're the producer of this new documentary. It's called Dysconnected. What prompted you to create this particular project?
Well, as with many of my projects, it starts with being a dad of four kids. Honestly, I've got three girls right in that teenage area, you know, from 12 to 21. And it is a hard time to be a teenager. And so with this film, and frankly, with the previous film, which you were in, called Unprotected, my motives were very much the same. Like, I'm a dad who is really concerned, scared in some senses about what's going on with these kids. And it doesn't even matter like how protective you are of the kids, right? Like, you can be a homeschooler, but unless you're living in a cave somewhere with like zero electronics in your life, they are going to be affected. And so, you know, the latest thing, I mean, for a while there, you know, we were very concerned about porn and sexting, and of course we still are, but now, Dr. Morse, these girls are coming, they're 13 years old, and half their classmates have transitioned and are starting to take off-label synthetic hormones and go into surgery. And you're like, whoa,
right,
what's going
right.
on here, right? And so that's what motivated me. We've got to get, like, what is going on? We got to get to the bottom of this. What's, like, this wave of trans girls?
Yes.
Even in this small, you know, like in the small social circle that I run in, you know, it's not like I'm have, you know, interacting with thousands of public school kids or whatever, but even in my small social circle, the trans thing was very strong. And also, as a secondary thing, I noticed I was doing a little bit of teaching. We're back in California now, as you can see by the video. But for a while, I was in Oregon, and I was doing a little teaching in a charter school as part of the public system. Okay, so it was like a conservative-ish school, but the public system in Oregon, well, Dr. Morris, to be in the public school system in Oregon, even to just get into a classroom, you have to go through so much crazy propaganda. Yeah. And nutty, like, sex ed stuff as the teacher. That sort of opened my eyes, too. I'm like, what? This is insane. Like, something is weird here. Something is really powerfully wrong. And so I wanted to try to get to the bottom of that.
Well, you know, I want to talk about the content of your film, first of all. You know, at some point, obviously, that's the main thing we want to talk about. But what got you into the business of making documentaries in the first place? Because there are a lot of ways to deal with this type of stuff. You know, there's a guy out there called Billboard Chris who walks around the streets wearing a big signboard and stuff. I think he's in your picture.
He's a friend of mine. Good guy.
So everybody has their way, you know, of trying to deal with this stuff. But how did documentaries become your thing?
I sort of fell into it, honestly, and I was a bit I was exploring, interestingly enough, I guess for me, I was exploring the Catholic Church. I'm a convert, and so this was back years and years ago, and I didn't want to, I was a evangelical evangelist minister at the time, and I had written a book. I'm more of an author, actually. I mean, when it comes down to it, I wouldn't have foreseen myself as a filmmaker, although that's primarily what I do now. But I like to write. You know, I was writing a book, and I had just finished a book, and I didn't want to do that, and people don't read that many books anymore. And I was like, well, how can I tell the story without, and I had a friend here in Hollywood who was a documentary filmmaker, and I sort of pitched it to him, and we scrounged together just enough money. I mean, God was really in it. We scrounged together just enough money to get ourselves in a small little bit of equipment out to Austin, Texas, actually. And we started interviewing atheists who had become Christian. That was the original. For whatever reason, in Austin, there was we could go and spend a few days and get like 5, 6, 7 interviews. Some great people. I think I'm like Jennifer Fulweiler and Abby Johnson, people that are friends of ours. And so we did that, and we put together a trailer, and that became my first film, Convinced. And it was just a tremendous experience. And people are really, like, still to this day, powerfully moved. RCIA classes all over the country are using that film as a way to introduce people to the faith. And I realized the power. I mean, and I'm a guy who likes movies, you know, I'm a guy who likes watches series on TV, you know, like, I like the visual medium, but I realized its power to really, like, tell a story, educate people, but do it in a way that, like, powerfully moves people to action. And so after that, I mean, I was hooked. The filmmaking medium is just so fantastic at, if done right, right? I mean, obviously, correct, there's a lot of bad ones out there.
If
done right, it can really not only, like, teach you something, and maybe teach you something in a way that you didn't even realize you were sort of in a classroom, you know, like, you go away from it, you know, something new, but you didn't, you know, it's not like a lecture. But what you do know is that you feel strongly now that in some way. So with this film, it's been, you know, people walk away from it like, oh, I didn't know that, for one thing. They'll say like, I didn't know all that was going on, but then they'll also be like, nah, I really feel like I need to do something now. I can't be on the sidelines.
Yeah. So let's get into Dysconnected now and talk about the substance of the film itself. The opening montage it follows the story of one detransitioner with a lot of other people's stories mixed in, and experts and so on and so forth mixed in with it. But there's one person whose story it really is. Why don't you start by telling just briefly her story, and telling, you know, we're going to see telling is not nearly as powerful as showing.
And yeah, well, and this
very
is,
dramatic this is, showings of this girl.
This is the one of the beauties as a documentary filmmaker of our social media age, is that these kids just document everything, right? They've got the phone in front of them recording every step of their life. And so we do follow a young lady named Daisy from the time she's about 15, and she actually looks younger. I mean, you look at her and she kind of feels like she looks like about 12 when she starts this process. but she was about 15 and got caught up in the wave back in 2015, which is when it started, the social media wave of transitioning. And so she did a vlog, you know, a personal YouTube channel, and she became quite popular on YouTube all during this time. And she documented her transition first to like she was gay, you know, she identified as gay for a little bit, but then non-binary. And then she decided, no, I am male. And so we see that at the beginning all the way through. In fact, the beginning sort of introduction is her heading into the hospital for euphemistically what they call top surgery, but a double mastectomy, right? A breast removal surgery. And we see her getting up in the morning and going in for the surgery. And it's, it shocks people, I think, when it'll grab you because it's vile, you know, she's so happy about it.
Yes.
You know, she's so happy about it.
Yes, yes, yes. And that's what was amazing about this thing. You had nothing to do with that footage. She had created that herself for reasons of her own, right? And she thought she was doing a good thing by doing the transition. She thought she was doing a good thing by recording it and sharing it. And so here we are as kind of looking in after the fact, we as the audience, we have a clue where this is going. We don't really know where it's going. There's a surprise ending, actually a wonderful surprise ending.
It is. We don't want to give it away, but it's such a fantastic, which again, I did not coach Daisy at all in that. We have this beautiful ending at the end. We're at the end. It's like this mirror. So we're not going to give it away. You got to watch the movie, but see her doing the vlog, at the end too, talking into her phone, right? Very different context.
So this is what's so potent about it, as you said, and I didn't put this together until you just said it, is that this generation is used to taking pictures of themselves, sharing with themselves. Old fuddy-duddies like us think they're being narcissistic by sharing every bite of food that they have and, you know, all that kind of thing. But in this case, it turned out to serve a divine purpose, you could say, that she had done this for whatever reason she might have had. Here's my big question. How did you find her? Or did she find you? And she agreed to let you use this stuff. Tell us that little corner of the story.
Such a sweet young lady. I mean, how I find anybody with these projects, you got to do a lot of prayer and see what happens. Because I think I had... with any of these projects, I usually reach out to people that I know or have a connection with, maybe that have written a book about it, right? So we've got, I probably reached out to Ryan T. Anderson, who wrote When Harry Became Sally. I was up in Oregon, and I had Abigail Favali, who is a new author, great book, The Genesis of Gender. She was one of the first people I interviewed. Just logistically, she was down the road, so that was nice. She was actually teaching in Oregon. I was living in Oregon. So early on, this would have been probably, I don't know, 18 months ago, right? A long time. Movies take a long time. And I reached out to Abigail. I knew she was writing the book. The book wasn't coming out yet, but I had some friends at Ignatius Press, and we talked to Abby. She's a lovely lady, and we did a beautiful interview with her, and not knowing where the movie was going to go. And so I asked Abigail, hey, you're writing this book. Are there any people that I should talk to? And one of the people she mentioned was Daisy. She's like, hey, she's transitioning. She's detransitioning. And she might be a good person to talk to. I reached out to her. She, you know, they're all smartly, right? If I had a documentary filmmaker reach out to me, honestly, I'd be very hesitant because as a filmmaker, I know what I can do with your footage. You know, I can make it say whatever I want. Obviously, you want an honest person. So I'd be very hesitant. She asked some great questions at the beginning, you know, what's it all about? And we had a nice long discussion, and she finally agreed for us to go out to Chicago. So about a year ago, we flew out to Chicago, and we ended up going out to Chicago two times. And with some extra footage. So you'll see Daisy throughout. But that was our first trip, was to get to visit her. And then a bunch of other people are in there, like Walt Heyer. But Daisy was just so kind in agreeing and then trusting me to tell her story, which that's a tough thing for anybody to do, I think. But and then what you do after that, you know, to find the rest of them is ask each person, like, do you know anybody I should talk to, you know? Mm-hmm. And it was amazing how God opened the doors. In fact, sometimes I was in Washington, D.C. To visit, well, like Ryan T. Anderson is there, you know, a wonderful scholar, and some of the people at the John Paul II Institute, we were talking to some of them.
Yes,
And we had another couple of interviews actually scheduled, but they fell through. And we're there and we had like two extra days. And I'm scrambling, you know, like, who can we talk to? And that was the time we actually learned about, I didn't even know about Maria Koeffler and Advocates Protecting Children. And this, you know, just this wonderful, fantastic organization they've started. And Maria is a lovely lady. Well, she's there. And so I reached out to her really fast, you know, like, Maria, can we do this interview? She was very kind. She came out and she's fantantic, right?
Yes,
you know
is.
This. She's so good.
Yeah.
And so we talked about that. And that was
just full disclosure. We had Maria at our last two conferences. She's been a speaker. And last year we gave her and her friend Erin Brewer an award for Activist of the Year for their work as in Advocates Protecting Children. So you can see more footage of those two ladies at the Ruth Institute's channel because we've talked to them numerous times, and they are not only are they great ladies with a great message, they are on fire. You know, you cannot stop these ladies. They are on it. So,
and Maria just fell into our lap. I mean, God just opened the door. We weren't even supposed to talk to her. Well, after you talked to Maria and all of her people, so then we went to Utah to talk to Erin, because I didn't know about Erin either, right?
Yeah.
And Erin introduced us to Billy Burley and also Dr. Patrick Lappert, who, you know, is just a genius at this stuff. And so that's how, you know, like, the one door opens another door. And in the end, I mean, it wasn't me. You know, I can't take credit for it, but the people we have in this movie are just fantastic. I mean, they're just so articulate and so passionate, and so their heart is just so in the right place.
Yes. Yes, that's very true. And I would say that you have covered the same kind of bases that we like to cover in all of our different things that we deal with, which is the people who have actually had the experience that we call the witnesses. So Daisy and Erin and a few other people, they're your witnesses, right? That they've been there, done that, and this is what it's all about. Then you got your subject matter experts, right, who can give you the truth to counteract some of the crazy stuff that's out there. And Dr. Lappert is fantastic. And also, I would cite that that therapist whom I was not familiar with. And then you've got your activists, your on fire people who are trying to put the brakes on this thing, you know, and to get something done about it. So and you're doing networking. You know,
that's just, right. Well, you know, let me tell you about the so Pamela Garfield Yeager, who is the therapist in her. This was another I use the term God opening. And I should, full disclosure, like, not all of these people, just by the way, are Catholic, or not even all, they're not even all Christian. So it's and they were yet, you know, they're part of the project. And guys like Billboard Chris, just so kind and generous, like, we're all in the, you know, we're all fighting this together. It's a broad group. But Pam, the therapist, who does a fantastic job. So I tried probably, I don't know, 15 therapist, like, you cannot get teachers or therapists to come and talk about this. I asked everybody. Okay. And I don't know. That was one where I'm like, I don't know why we can't. Nobody was, you had people who agreed with you, but as you know, professionally, it is very difficult, right? It is very difficult to speak out in these institutions now, the public school, the counseling industry, just medical industry, very difficult. And so, Barry, we were almost done. We were done shooting. Pam was actually the last person we interviewed, and most of the movie was done before we even talked to her here up in San Francisco. The only reason she talked to us is that she was in a unique, I mean, she's a kind lady. She would have talked to us anyway, I believe, but she was in the unique position of having been on disability and not having to rely on, like, she did get fired actually over the vaccine mandates and stuff, but she was now in a position where, no, I got to speak out about this. And you know, thank God her livelihood was not at stake like with some of these others. But it just shows you that, like, the the stakes are very large here. Like, there's a lot of insidious stuff going on. So it was, you know, it was fantastic to get her. She adds so much to the film.
Oh, yes.
Realize that it was almost impossible to get a therapist to come on record. So, you know, take that for what it's worth.
Wow. That is amazing. That is a very important point. Ruthies, listen up. Listen to what the nice man just told you. Okay. The conference we put on in 2021 was called Reclaiming the Professions for Life and Marriage. And what we talked about through the whole summit was about how the different professions have become corrupted by the sexual revolution, not just gender dysphoria and trans stuff, but all of it across the board. And it's been going on a long time. So this nice lady that you got to appear in your film, her livelihood was not at stake. She was independent. Somehow she had a source of income that she could rely on rather than, without worrying about whether she was ever going to get to practice.
Let me put out a quick plug for her. So you can go find her at The Truthful Therapist. So she has started her own, private business now, because that's what she's had to do. It's not like she can go back to counseling now.
Right.
You know, she sort of burned that bridge. So all these folks, they're so brave. That was one of the things I really found, is that a lot of people, you know, like I said, you send out a bunch of feelers, you know, who can be a part of it, who's got time. You know, some people are just, you know, scheduled out. I get it. Fair enough. But there were some people, Dr. Morse, that I really fully expected, like, you should be in this. Like, what are you doing? And they said it wasn't because they didn't have time. It's like, no, I don't want the pushback. Like, I don't want to be hated. I don't want to, you know. And I'm like, listen, if not you, who's going to say something? Like, you got to stand up and talk. So I was sadly disappointed in some folks that I talked to that just refused to come on camera. Yeah. But then a lot of people, so the people realize that the people who came on camera are taking great risk, like personally, professionally, to come on camera and say this. I mean, you know that you do it all the time. You face immense backlash for this. Mm-hmm. And it is a time in our culture, though, where you have to. I mean, you're exactly right about the professions. They're absolutely overtaken. It's insane what's going on.
And so one of the patterns that you notice is people who don't need the income, either they're retired, or they're women who have husbands who are working. All right.
That's right.
And you think about some of the, you know, that's certainly been my situation. You know, my husband made the Ruth Institute possible. I tell people that all the time. My husband's the first and still finest friend of Ruth. Without him, none of this would have happened, you know, because I didn't have to worry about a tenured position or anything like that. You know, I burned that bridge a long time ago.
You talk to people. It is either that. It's like Dr. Lappert, who still has a practice, not in the same, not licensed in the same way, because he's retired now in that sense.
Right.
But he wouldn't have been able to continue to do that. A guy like Ryan Anderson, I mean, he straight told me, he's like, well, I've lost all the friends that I'm going to lose anyway, so I just speak out. I just speak out on this. That's kind of my position.
What the heck?
I'm like, listen, okay.
I want to put in a plea for all of you who are retired, who may be watching this. If you are retired from any profession and you have a source of income, you do not get to sit on the sidelines, okay, people? You need to find a way to be involved. Like Dr. Lappert, like there are retired judges who are getting things done. There are a variety of ways that you can use your expertise and connections and knowledge about your profession to get something done in your retirement. This may turn out to be the most important thing you ever do in your life, right? Is to do something to reclaim your profession for truth, right? Because you guys know what I'm talking about. I don't have to fill you up with this. I know there are a lot of our viewers who know exactly what I'm talking about here, right? So you had this wonderful twist at the end of the film, which we're not going to give away.
That's right.
But among the people that you interviewed and interacted with, Don, what was the biggest surprise that you encountered? What did you learn that you didn't know, or that what did you hear that just turned your head completely in surprise? Tell us. I'm sure there were several. So tell us.
Yeah, there were several. I mean, the first one was like how many people were very, you know, weren't going to speak out. The second one, again, I'll try to find a positive one too. But the second one was actually kind of negative too, in that I probably wasn't as aware of just how dark and insidious and satanic this whole thing is when you start peeling back the layers of what's actually going on. And, you know, like in the film, so we take very, you know, several angles on this thing, right? This is not, we look at it from several different perspectives. We talk to a lot of different people, but it is dark. Like, it is evil when you get down into it. It is very painful attack on the human person itself. Like, to have these young girls, and it's just so sad. I mean, that was part of it too. Like, I saw, you know, I was reading a post the other day on some thread, and the girl was regretting her decision, just a young teenage girl, and she asked the question, so when do my boobs grow back? You know, and they're just so ignorant, and they're lied to, like the depth of deception.
Yes,
that we're forcing on these young kids. Oh, this is just a temporary thing. Just pause your puberty, start it whenever you want. You know, these are just minor procedures. No, it's horrendous. You know, these are evil attacks on the human person. So that the depth of it, I wasn't quite, I mean, in the end, it didn't surprise me. At the beginning, I'm like, wow, this is a little bit darker than I thought. And then to come back, I mean, I don't think you're talking about the institutions. I mean, I don't think you can overestimate just how much the institutions have been overtaken by this, and how strongly we got to fight back on this thing. Like, that was the teachers and the doctors and the counselors. We were down at just recently, just down the freeway here at the Anaheim Convention Center. They had 10,000 pediatricians here just a couple of weeks ago for their annual convention. And so a great big group, a unity rally, got together outside just very peacefully and quietly with our signs, you know, like, nobody's born in the wrong body, trying to educate doctors. But just the depth of craziness within the medical profession. I'm a cynical guy, maybe in general, like, yeah, okay, maybe the doctors are being led down a wrong path here, but man, they really are. Like,
did people react to you as they were going in and out of the convention center? You're standing there with your sign, no one's born in the wrong body. What kind of reaction did you get?
I think you had some favorable ones. You had doctors who were walking by, thank you very much. There was a lot of like, hey, we agree with you, but, and then you had to try to hand them something and they're like, well, no, I can't, you know, you get a lot of this, right? People, mm-hmm. they agree with you, mm-hmm. but they can't, even people will take a picture of the flyer with their phone, but not take the flyer because they can't be caught with the contraband. You know, it's like, there's that mentality. We had, you know, there was counter protesters there. There was the TRAs, the trans rights activists, were there. You had, unfortunately, you also had like the crazy preachers who were the loudest of all, who frankly were giving everybody a bad name, like just mm-hmm. the irritating, you know, burn in hell kind of folks. So you had this big group. But yeah, I mean, there was I don't know about percentages, but you had a lot of like just walk by. You had a few just give you the finger as you went by. You had a few like yell. You had the activists who were yelling. And then there was that like, I appreciate what you're doing. Some were vocal. There was a few vocal doctors that, hey, appreciate you being out here. They take the stuff. So mm-hmm. praise God for them. But too many for my liking were, hey, you know, give you a little nod, like good job, but I'm not going to associate with you.
Right. So, right. I can't be seen with you. You're bad for business. I can't be seen with you. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's really, but that's what we're dealing with.
Tell
us, I think you brought several things to mind here. One is the stories of the detransitioners, and we want to get back to the, cause Daisy was not the only detransitioner in your film. But also the darkness, the propaganda. Tell people a little bit about what these young people encounter that pushes them into one direction.
Right. Well, and how dark it is, but how like bright it appears, right? How welcoming and joyful and bright that it appears. And so you think about like how propaganda movements work. It's so multifaceted. So if you're a 12-year-old girl and you're just, you know, entering your teenage years, I mean, it's a crazy time, right? That 12 to 16-year-old, that's a crazy time to be a girl. Well, today, what are you going to face? Well, if you attend school, you're going to have hallways lined with rainbow flags and GSA club banners, and your teachers are going to emphasize just how cool it is to be part of this group, you know, some sort, anything but cis, right? Anything but straight. Straight is not even a term they use anymore, but right. Anything but cis is the cool, the happy part of the school. And then you're on your phone. That's the other thing, right? You're on your phone, likely. You're on your phone probably 20 hours a day, likely, and you're just immersed in social media. And what is social media? Well, it is filled with, I would say, two things. Porn, from light to dark. I mean, it's just, you get on TikTok today. I mean, so let me tell you a little side story here. So I get kicked off TikTok regularly. Okay. Because you post your videos and they ban you for life. And so then you have to change your birth date and your email to get back. I do it just because that's where everybody is there. I mean, the numbers of videos, you know, you can get 200,000 views. So a Maria Kefler video, for example, got 200,000 views in the first day before they banned me for life under that account. I mean, that's just how so I go back there. But I'll tell you what, Dr. Morris, so they don't know who, like, you know, you open up TikTok and all they know, they don't know anything, but what do you they feed you stuff, right? So I know what they're getting fed because I'm anonymous. You see what I'm saying? Like, so what are they getting fed? It's nothing but naked girls. I mean, I was amazed at just how pervasive TikTok is with the porn, like not explicit, like, but just naked, half naked women in their G-strings walking, like, constantly. So you're faced with this as a 13-year-old girl. You've got porn, and if you go down that track, it gets more violent. You also know that who are the popular people on these social media platforms? The trans people. If you change your pronouns on Instagram, you're a superstar almost immediately. Like, you could be a nobody yesterday, change your pronouns, and you're a superstar today. Now you've got 10,000 followers. You want to start posting a few videos on there. Oh, now you've got a million followers. Like, it's that sort of attitude where everything, like from the teaching, the assignments, even your math assignments. In Oregon, the public school math assignments would be stuff like, so your cousin just changed his pronouns and came out as trans, and we're going to do a sociological experiment, and how many states would he be accepted in? I mean, it's just insane. The type of, like, every subject is full of this stuff. And so they're just getting it from every direction. I mean, who would want to be on the outside? You know, the old argument was, well, it has to be biological, because who would want to be a social outcast and come out as gay? Well, it's exactly the opposite now, right? The social outcasts are the ones who don't come out as some sort of trans. It's a complete social push towards creating these type of kids. It's an absolute grooming is an accurate term here for what they're doing. They're making these kids into this. It's a vortex that they get sucked into.
And one of the things that was very potent in your film was Maria Kefler's discussion of the autistic kids.
Yeah.
And the way in which the autistic kids get groomed and drawn into this, because they're socially awkward. And now all of a sudden they fit in with somebody, right?
That's right.
And so that's a deliberate plan. That's a deliberate strategy that somebody's doing to bring kids along into the non-binary sexual revolutionary mentality, and to think that they're picking out these vulnerable children, these socially vulnerable, socially isolated children, the kids on the autism spectrum to be doing this. You know, this is to me, this is really dark stuff, and people don't believe it until they see it, until it's right in their face. They don't believe anybody can be this dark.
No, the autism thing, I mean, I don't know if people realize that yet. It's at least 30%, probably closer to 50% of these kids. 50% of these kids are autistic, and there's several characteristics, like you said, like the social. They're told they're socially awkward, and that they get this welcoming cult like thing that they can be into, but also just the body. Like, they do have autism, is, you know, in obviously it's on a spectrum, but they're just not comfortable in their body. That's the this type of thing that it is, right? And so trans comes along and says, oh, well, the reason you're not comfortable in your body is because you're in the wrong body. Let's change it, right? And it's a very compelling message. And then they're in their head a lot. They're thinking very clearly. They have sort of black and white thinking where they think about stuff for a long time and then they make a decision. And that's it. Now we're locked in. Right. And so they get locked in. It's very hard to talk them out of it. And once you see this, it's one of those things where, like, once you see it, start to look around you in your social circles or online and just recognize, if you're familiar at all with people on the autism spectrum, just how many of these girls clearly are on the spectrum somewhere. And it just is so sad, you know, that these poor, they've got enough, you know, going against them anyway, right? They're fighting this fight through life. And then, hey, let's mutilate your body and put you on synthetic hormones for the rest of your life. Like, terrible.
I want to call attention to something just real quickly. This is something Erin Brewer helped us figure out. And by the way, her story in that film is very compelling and much more detailed than I've ever heard her tell before. So that was kudos for that. Yeah, but one of the things she helped us see at our last program was the word trans gets used in a variety of ways. This film of yours is focused on the teenage girls who think they're in the wrong body. But the word trans is also used to describe people like Bruce Jenner. And Richard Levine, who calls himself Rachel now, and Thomas Donnelly, who now calls himself Giselle. Okay, these are men who lived their whole lives as men and who fathered children. They've been married and they're often very powerful men. Okay, they're not beta males, right? They're kind of like alpha male guys. And their thing is that they get sexually aroused seeing themselves in women's clothing and thinking themselves as women. Completely different kind of setup than what these teenage girls are going through.
This is very, very important for people to understand. We talk about that at the beginning of the film. It's autogynephilia is the term for that. Mm-hmm. And yeah, it's a sexual dysfunction. Okay. It's a perversion. Inevitably, I mean, I'm going to say 100% of the time, these are guys with porn addiction who have just severe sexual dysfunction. That's what's so, again, that's so evil about this. Like these are the guys getting invited to the White House, you know, these crazy guys who have porn addictions and autogynephilia, dressing up in women's clothes, and they're the ones getting invited to the White House. Two problems. I mean, that's what it presents as trans to the culture, not realizing that it's all these girls that are getting sucked into this nonsense. But also, I mean, doubly, these guys, they are also later on, like, this is all very heavily associated with a pedophilia thing, right? Like the whole sexualization of the culture is creating this generation of pornified kids, abused kids. And so, yeah, it's so, we don't think about it very clearly. I mean, you think these middle-aged guys that are leaving their family to go dress up as women, I mean, how disgusting. I'm sorry, but think about their families.
Exactly. We call them trans widows.
Yeah.
These women, they're trans widows because their husband left them to become trans. But I do want to go back to this, to the autogynephiles. Let's just stick with that. Some of the autogynephiles are rich and powerful men who are pumping money into this. Okay. So the Pritzker family, right? That's a real thing, right? Because they've had positions of authority and power, right? They've been able to move the ball forward and they're taking all this dark stuff behind them. Whatever you think of Bruce Jenner, there's a lot of dark stuff following him that he's offering cover for. The other thing I want to say about guys like Kinsey and Money and Wilhelm Reich, who's one of the founders of the sexual revolution, what they really wanted, Don, in my opinion, you know, the core thing that they wanted is they wanted to be able to say all the sexual taboos are unnecessary. We can do anything we want sexually. Everything will be fine. We just have to get rid of the taboos, people feeling bad about it. Well, the only way you can do that is if you believe that children don't really need their parents, right? Because if you believe children need their parents, then it actually matters quite a lot who you have sex with, right? Because mom and dad start fooling around with somebody else, you know, you're not going to have mom and dad's attention on the children if they've got a new boyfriend, new girlfriend, new sets of kids, and all the rest of it, right? So the traditional Christian sexual ethic protected that interest of children. So when these guys say, I'm going to flush all that, they have to, in their mind, say, well, the kids won't be harmed by that. And what they all came up with the same thing, which is the kids are sexual beings, and they want sex, and they're happy with sex, and, you know, and all of that. So even if they were not, even if not a single one of them themselves was a pedophile, what they did was create something that attracts pedophiles, right? You turn that ideology loose in society, who's going to gather around that flag?
Yeah, well, that's right. I mean, you talk about guys like Freud and his disciple Kinsey. I mean, mm-hmm. if the meaning of life is orgasm, essentially, mm-hmm. this is mm-hmm. what they went with. Like guys like Reich, like actually thought that, you know, orgasm releases things into the air that's good for people. This energy, you know, like severely superstitious, anti-scientific, evil stuff. But if the meaning of life is that, it has to be the meaning of life for everybody. The meaning of life can't start at puberty, right? It can't start when you become a sexual being. Yeah. So then the kids have to be sexual beings, or else their philosophy of life doesn't make any sense.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Now, let me ask you this, because I think it might have been Aaron Brewer who brought this up, and I don't think it ended up in the film, but I thought it was a great point. She's like, well, where this lowering of the age of consent for all of these different things that you can do, like informed consent mm-hmm. Laws. She thinks, I think, and I don't want to speak for Aaron, but I believe it was Aaron who told me this. So hopefully I'm correct, Aaron, but that we're not just lowering the age of consent for drugs ultimately, but for sexual activity.
Oh gosh. Oh gosh, there are people who have that as their objective. There's no question in my mind that there are people who have that as their objective. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, I think it is important for people to see, like, if you within this philosophy and you start lowering the consent, like what's the end game here? Like, where is this going? Especially with a Freudian sort of Kinsey philosophy of like orgasm as the meaning of life. Yeah, you're going to end up in some dark places here.
Yeah, that's right. And then at the same time, we're shocked that children are being sexually abused, you know, and then Don, it turns out I've talked with a lot of sexual abuse survivors, and I've yet to hear somebody say, oh, you know, the only reason it was a problem is because the people around me thought it was a problem. Really, it was okay with me. You know, that's what the ideologues want the kids to think, right? They want people to think of if the adults would just stop being upset about it, it wouldn't be a problem. I have yet to see anybody who talks like that. You know, that's fantasy. Right. That's just complete fantasy. Totally. So tell us, we don't want to give away Daisy's whole story, but you've got some very moving moments in that film. Share with us just a couple of some of your more inspiring impressions or moments.
The detransitioner stories are obviously, you know, those are the ones that really get you. And I actually think there was a moment in the making of the film when a couple moments, but actually I think the first one was when we talked to Erin, and she, I mean, like you said, she tells her story in a way that I had not heard before, and it's just very powerful. And I came away from that day. We talked to her and Billy actually at the same time. We flew out to Utah and spent some time with both of them, and, you know, just fantastic people. But that was the day I walked away from that interview like, wow, we got something here. Like, this is going to be a powerful film, assuming I don't mess it up, you know, in my editing. But what we have here, this story that she's told and the way that she tells it, is really like moving and compelling. And then Daisy, you know, Daisy, we ended up going back to Chicago a few times, like I said, and that was interesting because I'll give away part of the story. Okay, so during we went out, we talked to her near the beginning of shooting, and we did a bunch of other interviews, and then I learned last Christmas that, well, actually I knew she was getting married, but there was some other developments with the marriage that will be a surprise at the end of the movie. So we flew back out and talked to her again, and she gave us some footage with her and her new husband that was fantastic. And then I asked her near the end, the movie was basically in the can, you know, we got the composer is filming the last, the last notes, and we got the premiere date coming up. And it was within the last 2 weeks that the footage at the end of the movie, I don't know if you realize this, that was about 6 days old when we premiered.
Wow.
That.
Wow, that's that so
footage,
cool.
Yeah, the footage came in like at the end. I had asked her, I'm like, hey, Daisy, do you think... so she said, yeah, I think that's a good idea. I'll try that. We'll see how it works. And it worked out fantastic. I mean, mm-hmm. I could not have asked for anything better. Again, we won't surprise it, but inevitably, like the theater, when we had a nice red carpet event here in Orange County at Christ Cathedral, and, you know, the place is just in tears at the end, you know, and it really moved people. What I like is that it moved. Like I said, we had Gays Against Groomers were there, and a lot of like atheist, secular, humanist people were at the movie, you know, that we all, I think generally we didn't have any hardcore anti-activists. We tried to keep them away, but this broad spectrum, you know, across religious, political divide, I would say. And they were all like moved. Like it was, they all walked away saying, okay.
Yeah.
Either A, I'm confirmed in what I did, but secondly, we have to do something about this. And so I was, you know, very, very pleased with the reception and that story at the end. So Daisy just is such a sweet girl that agreed to all of this. And when I asked her, I'm like, hey, could you do the phone thing at the end? You know, like, she's like, yeah, absolutely. So that was awesome.
That's great. So this is a good time, since we're coming to the end of our time together. I would like you to tell people a few things that they can do with the movie or about the movie. I mean, can people just go buy the DVD, or can they arrange film showings of it? Or, you know, what are some of the ways that you're seeing people use the film? Give people a range of ideas that they can use.
Sure. So, okay. So the easiest, fastest way to watch it today, you can go to my website, donjohnsonmedia.com, and then click on the link. I actually have Runaway Planet Pictures is my movie site, but you can go, it'll take you to runawayplanet.com, and you can stream the movie today. So that's one way to watch it. You can also, the DVDs are going to be out, I believe, within the next 10 days from Ignatius Press. So they're the ones distributing the DVDs. So if you like a hard copy, and frankly, I would do both if I'm, you know, not just selfishly either, but in our digital age, I think it is ever more important to actually have hard copies of everything. So I have stopped buying Kindle books. I mean, sometimes I will just for research purposes, but I keep the hard copies because right. It's just too easy to erase, mm-hmm. too easy to lose. It's not locked in your mind as much. So I'd say, hey, buy the DVD from Ignatius, download the stream and watch it. But then here's the important thing. We absolutely will do screenings. Like, so if you want to arrange a screening at your whatever community center, church, we'll absolutely do that. If you want one of us to come, if you want one of us to be interviewed, Daisy's doing interviews. Walt Heyer. So, you know, Walt, he's an old friend of both of ours. Walt graciously told me, and he said I could quote him. He's like, this is the movie I've been waiting 30 years for.
Yeah.
So and this is a guy who's been in a lot of movies, right? He's been doing this for decades. He said his word was masterpiece, the one I've been waiting 30 years for. So I appreciate that. But Walt's doing interviews for the movie too, right? So we need to get the word out. But this is the important thing. This is what I have found. People will agree with you. It's like being on the street, handing out pamphlets. People will agree with you. They are very, very hesitant to share this. Just in general. They like, yeah, I loved it. Awesome movie. Best thing I've ever seen. Oh, did you post that on Facebook or did you tell your friends? Oh, hey, you know, I've got this trans friend. I don't want to offend him. Listen, this is not a subject that you can worry about that. Okay. Mm-hmm. This is not a subject where yes, maybe somebody's going to be offended, but we have to stand up. And I think hopefully after you see the film that you will say, this is a topic where I do have to stand up. This is what I tell. In fact, I told people this who didn't want to be in the movie. I said, okay, fair enough. But in hopefully in as little as, you know, 1 year, but in 20 years, we're going to look back on this, you know, like we look back on lobotomies and some of these other travesties. And we're going to say, why didn't more people speak up? Like, you don't want to be on the wrong side of this in 20 years, looking back and say, yeah, I just, you know, I was there, but I didn't. You're going to want the record to show that you said the right thing to start saving some of these girls. Okay. Yeah. Because there's 40, there's a Reddit group of 40,000 strong of detransitioners. I mean, the wave that's coming these girls coming out the other side of this. I mean, and it's lifetime. These girls are affected now for a lifetime, right?
Yeah.
And the wave that's coming, you want to be on the right side of this thing, and we want to help stop a few more girls from going down that path. So please watch the movie and then share it in whatever way. Get a poster. I'll provide you a poster at your church or share it on social media. Yeah, we do get shadow banned a little bit on social media, but it can't be one of those things where we're on the sidelines. And I think if we can get more and more people like, no, this is a matter of life and death. We got to, I know the Ruth Institute has a ton of resources for helping people to share. Because listen, there's a lot of parents and pastors out there who feel completely underwater on this thing. This is another thing I'm hoping to help people. They're over their heads. They don't know what to say. They know they've got the issue, but they don't know what to do about it. Maybe your pastor needs to see the movie. Maybe he needs to realize that there's stuff. Maybe your pastor needs to go to the Ruth Institute page and get some resources. There's some stuff on my page too, some books. There are sermons to preach on this stuff. We're way, way too silent on this in the culture, way too silent. So we got to get off our comfortable, sit back and nod quietly, hey, I appreciate it. You're doing a good thing. Like, no, you need to.
you need to do a good thing too.
Yeah, that's right. You need to do it.
So just to be clear, you and your organization, people will come and help you put on a screening at your church or your school or whatever.
Yeah,
it is.
Totally. Well,
and that means you personally.
I can. Yeah. I mean, I'm not made of money, so you may have to like fly me out there. But if it's close by, I'm happy to do it. Right. Yeah. So a lot of, 20 million people here within a few miles of me in Southern California. So it is doable. We're very open to that. But we'll also just set you up so that you can show it, at your church. That's fine. I don't have to be there, but, we do ask, I know I get, this is a tough one. I understand. We get people like, hey, why isn't this for free on YouTube? I get it. I understand that this message should be out there. On the other hand, it's incredibly expensive, and these things I can't make the next one. We can't do this to fly several times to Chicago and around the country to talk to all these people. That's just not the way it works. So you have to. Right. I think that's another, along with sharing this stuff, like, why don't we have better Christian movies? No, you can't raise money for these things, right? They expect them for free. So I would ask, like, hey, if you want to put on a screening, don't like figure out a way where you can pay the public screening fee or something like that to help us out a little bit. Again, I know that sounds like, oh, aren't, no, it, it's this is not, well, you know this, Dr. Morris. Nobody in this is doing it for the money. Okay.
No, there's no money in this.
No, that's exactly right.
That's exactly
right.
Look, you guys, if you're gonna put on a school play for your school, you would have to pay for the rights to use the script from whatever if you're gonna put on Charlie Brown Christmas at your Christian school, you have to pay something for the rights to use the material. That's just how it is. That's how creative stuff works.
Yeah, just
so, and the worker is worth his hire. That's biblical concept here, right? So so I do hope that people will support your film, that they will see that there's a screening fee, that they will not balk at it, that they will pay.
Well, it's very reasonable. Yeah,
right. I mean, you know come on, you guys.
I'm just asking you, if you see something that's really good, I'm not even mine, just anything, like, be willing to support that by sharing it.
That's right.
Buying, that's right. Paying the screening fee, whatever. That's how the next thing gets made. And these are having an impact. Like, it's 88 minutes long, right? So 88 minutes, and you've potentially saved a girl from a lifetime of medicalization, and maybe more than that. Yeah. It is having those kind of effects, like opening people's eyes. So I'm excited about it. I think it's, I was really happy with the initial response and how people are not only their eyes are open, but like I've said a couple times, like, what really thrilled me is like people are willing to now get off the couch and say, I cannot sit by it. And that's, you've been preaching this for a long time. Hard to get people motivated.
Right. And people, when you think about what Don's asking of you, you know, in terms of payment and stuff like that. I just want you to be aware that Planned Parenthood is making a lot of money off of selling puberty blockers. That's their new cash cow. So Don's going up against Planned Parenthood and Big Pharma and Martine Rosenblatt, who you'll see in the film. You know, he's going up against the people on the other side of this thing. The Gnostic death cult has a lot of money to spend. All right. And, you know, if you care, you need to show that you care either by actions or money or both. And I just can't emphasize that enough. I put people on my program that I think are worthy of your support, people. All right. I know you all support me, the Ruth Institute, and I want you to just support my friends. I have a lot of smart friends. I have a lot of talented friends. I got a lot of brave friends, all wrapped up here in Don Johnson. So I expect you guys to go help him in his movie, and you're going to be moved by it. Listen, you guys, this movie is going to help you. It's going to help your teachers and your counselors and your therapists and your priest who doesn't know what they don't know what to say. Okay. It's going to give them what they need to know what to say. All those people of influence who are on our side and who are sitting around tongue tied because they can't figure out how to get through the massive propaganda that's out there. But Don's created something here that's really going to help. So Don, I just want to thank you so much for being my guest today on this episode of the Dr. J Show. I wish you all good success with the film, Dysconnected.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Morrison. Just say thank you for all you do. I mean, you're a huge inspiration. It was the Ruth Institute that got me started. You were one of the first interviews we did for Unprotected, the previous doc, and your work has just led me down this path and been a huge inspiration and help. So keep fighting the good fight, and you know, together we'll end some of this madness, hopefully.
Right. Thanks so much, Don.
Thank you.